So on Monday, we talked about coral reproduction and that they do it all kinds of ways. From dioecious two houses to hermaphroditic, both sections in one polyp or one colony. They may be brooders or broadcasters, and they all use similar cues for synchronizing reproduction, but they, different species end up, especially in Hawaii, partitioning up the year, the lunar phase, the time of day. And just when we think we know when they're going to spawn, we know when the species is going to spawn, they sneak and do it at a different time. So there's lots that we still don't know about sexual reproduction in corals. I'm going to talk about asexual reproduction today. Can you reproduce asexually? Not so great. Can you grow? Yes, of course we can grow. As we'll see in corals, there's kind of a fine line separating growth and asexual reproduction. But keep in mind that we're complicated. If you break off a finger, it can't regrow a new you. Because there's a circulatory system in here, a lymph system in here, three layers of body tissue, bones, muscle. There's a lot of complicated things going on. Whereas if you break off a branch, a finger of coral, it's just two body layers, skeleton, and a very plastic morphology that can do a lot of different things. And there's no organs involved. Okay, so here's one of here's a great example of asexual reproduction coral. You guys know who this is, right? Venus species, Undus fusarium. Look at this life cycle. We call it programmed asexual reproduction. So here's what you often find out on the reef. It's just a pod, a bunch of similarly looking fungia, scutaria. It turns out that the life cycle is as we discussed before. Eggs and sperm planula in the water column settles down, grows into an adult. But on the bottom side of the adult, even if it's a dead looking adult like this, springs what's called an amphicolis, a little mushroom looking bit that can grow up, break off and grow up on its own and then become loose from the substratum. Isn't that wild? So it's like a little additional reproductive mode, but it's asexual. And we think that it's what results in this family, that they're all clones of the same gene type in this piece of the reef. So that's very interesting for the demographics and evolution of this species. Great for experimental manipulation. Another form of asexual reproduction that corals use is called polyp bilal. And often it happens after the environment gets hot. And you'll see literally an entire polyp, just the squishy part, come loose from the skeleton and plop down in a different place. It might float around for a little bit, plop that down and grow a new skeleton. And you can cause this to happen in some species in the lab. They've been caught in the act. Here's that finger coral that's really good at asexual reproduction. And it first got my attention as a brand new graduate student here. This is a reef up in the north end of Panohe Bay, Reef 42, my happy place. And you take a look at the top of this reef, it's 100% coral cover, nearly. And it looks like a patchwork of different morphologies and kind of colors repeated across the reef. And my simple question for my PhD actually was, are these clones replicated across the reef? What is the amount of asexual reproduction in this species, in this particular population? Is it the same in different populations? So and how do you figure that out? So I took a quadrat, a meter squared quadrat. One of the things I did was lay down on the reef for, 150 hours. In 10 feet of water. A tank can last a long time in 10 feet of water. And I drew out the borders of all of the colonies out there using a 10 by 10 centimeter grid. I mapped a 2 by 10 meter swath of the reef at Reef 42. Oops, sorry, go back. effect. And I used a variety of techniques. At the time, allozyme electrophoresis was one way we had of looking at genotypes, and it's still a really good way. Our DNA technology today won't tell you often if two individuals are different. We can barely get it to tell if two different species are different. But using allozyme methods, they had different UV absorbing compound spectral signatures, using a number of different techniques. Also, if two different clones are tied together or cable tied together, if they're different, they will have a rejection response. Like if their immune systems are different, they'll reject each other. If they're the same, they'll fuse. So that's a good way of finding out if they're the same or different or not. And so what you can see is that yes, there is a lot of asexual reproduction going on this reef, with clone red, the red clone, being really common. But look at this poor little brown guy. It was only found one time in this 2x10 swath, and it has since been completely overgrown. It's no longer in existence on the reef. I never saw it in another place, and it's been overgrown by the guys around it. It's been fun to follow these colonies through the years. Here's an example from Parietes rust. Paul Zocchio, Dr. Kool-Aid Rogers, and Steve Carl did a study on Molokai using that grafting that I just mentioned, where you tie two pieces together and see if they fuse or reject each other. Here's a fusion, and here's a rejection between two clones, or two samples that were placed side by side. Something that we can utilize from this ability of corals to reproduce asexually is coral farming, and with the ultimate intention of not just doing experimental science, but also of reef restoration. You can use this ability to propagate corals out in situ nurseries, up in the wild, strung on structures or on nets. They do really well. And the trade, the aquarium trade, has used this capability for a long time. Break off a branch of this beautiful coral and see if you can grow it in a different tank and then sell it to somebody else who wants to have it in their particular aquarium. So coral growth, as I said, is kind of the same thing as asexual reproduction, but sometimes the corals, as they grow, just grow all in one colony. We call that budding, or they can break off from the colony. We call that fragmentation. Removed from the parent colony. So I mentioned last time, when corals grow, can happen within the oral disc or outside of the oral disc, intratentacular or extratentacular. So here's an example of these calyces are actually dividing into two new polyps, two new calyces, or in this species, here's a new polyp coming up here, a new polyp coming up here. And it's species-specific, how a coral grows. This Parietes colony here is an example of, this is going to be extra tentacular growth, new little polyps showing up within the seed and kind between polyps that are already there. This is an extreme example of intratentacular budding. And the geometry and how this happens is still a bit of a mystery to me, I have to say, and I think to most of us, that this ability, this pattern of growth has evolved. But how fast do corals grow? You know? Some species, we can hardly tell that they're growing at all. Very, very slow. But some species of Acropora, and as Dr. Berkman mentioned, some of these with very fragile skeletons can grow fast because they're not putting a lot of energy and material into their skeleton. So they can grow up to 25 centimeters a year in linear extension. So these are long, friable is a good word. They're easily breakable branches. Finger coral that I was just talking about from Kanyame Bay grows about 3.5 centimeters a year. you drop by my office, I have a neat experiment, a common gardening experiment that I can show you, the actual pattern of growing from one little nubbin at the size of the end of your finger into and starting to branch over the course of just a year. And the massive varieties, how much do they grow? We say a 500-year-old colony. How long did it take to get to be 500 years old? 500 years. But it grows at the rate of about a centimeter a year. But keep in mind, that's in every direction. So it starts off this big, and then it grows a centimeter a year in each direction. So something this year, this big, can be 5 to 8 years old. Here's some examples of really big, massive varieties with a diver for scale. And Dr. Birkeland, a number of years ago, put out the Birkeland Challenge around the world to everyone in coral reef, the coral reef world, to say, can you find the biggest colony out there? And so far, the winner is Big Mama, she's affectionately known, found by Folly Tuolangi, who worked for the National Park Service. He's no longer with us. We really miss Folly. She, because sample was taken and eggs were found inside this entire colony that's 7 meters tall, 41 meters around, estimated to be about 360 years old, 200 million polyps imagined, all female. So far, that she takes the record, and she's off of Tau, American Samoa. So you take a plane to Pongo Pongo, and then you get on a little tiny plane flight over to Tau. It's about a 40-minute ride. It's like flying a Moana. And then in 60 feet of water offshore, it's Big Mama. Okay, you've seen this earlier, this image, and I want you to be familiar with the terminology, because this is what taxonomists particularly use when they're talking about, okay, this is what this coral has and this one doesn't, and that's why I think it's a different or similar. So we talked about the septum. All of this is produced, all of these skeletal elements, where do they come from? Does the skeleton come first or the tissue? The soft tissue deposits the skeleton. So the mesenteries that are hanging down inside the cilindron of polyp lay down underneath them the septa, the individual septa. The septa that you see right here, you see under the green dot. And in the middle, there's often a columella, abbreviated CL, which is kind of like a post in the middle of the calyx that the inside of the mesentery is supported on so that the mesentery can be bigger and expand from the edge of the calyx wall toward the center of the polyp. And then, so they hang there like drapes. I'm not going to go through all these today. I have too much, but you can review this again. We talked about it earlier on. And these, when the septa connect different polyps, they're called continuous when they're the same, or they may be discontinuous in every single calyx. Every single polyp has its own set of septa. And the variety is what makes coral so fascinating to us. How they can grow as simple hexagons up to the meandroid, or in this case flaviloid form, that we see out on the reefs. Oh, here's, sorry, just another example of intro tentacular budding. What's amazing to me, so this calyx, this hard calyx, skeletal form is already there, but in budding, there has to be some kind of dissolution of what's there, right, for budding to occur. Interesting process. And here's the morphology that we also talked about, all of the different colony morphologies that corals can exhibit on the reef, and they do. So how do you measure how fast corals grow? This is like watching paint dry? Worse. If it's negligible to 3.5 centimeters a year. The ways that people have gotten at it are these. You can actually stain the colonies and not hurt them. You can stain them with an alizarin dye, A-L-I-Z-A-R-I-N, alizarin, And that is you, you put some concentrated alizarin bread, shake it up in seawater, and put it in an Eppendorf tube. And then you put that in a baggie, not a Ziploc, a baggie, and you have a rubber band around your wrist. You go out in the field, and you put that over the colony that you want to measure. So you can't really, it's hard to do it on a massive colony. You need to be able to put this baggie over the colony, whatever you want to watch. And then you slip the rubber band off your wrist and put it around the bottom, down here. And then you kind of reach through the baggie and open up that tube and shake it around. So this is in the daytime, and the coral is depositing skeleton. You leave it overnight, come back first thing in the morning and take the baggie off. And you have stained the skeleton that was deposited that previous day and night. So then when, if you just leave that colony, hope it's okay, hope that you tagged it correctly and that you can find it in a year or 5 years, you come back and collect it, and then you have to kill it, bring it in, slice it in two so that you can look at the ring that you, the alizarin, laid down. So you can then count, then you can measure between 1991 and 2001. You can see the growth rings here, like rings on a tree. But you can see definitely the alizarin band that you laid down. I estimate that's about a centimeter a year for that massive.
Right.
Cool, huh? Corals lay down their own rings, as you just saw. And the reason for that is in the summertime, there's more sunlight, more, the days are longer. Wintertime, there's often more rainfall in tropical areas. So the corals actually deposit materials in their skeleton that can be picked up by UV light. And so this is a slice under the microscope of an Australian coral, and you can see some interesting bands to indicate that it's not just a uniform world that the corals are seeing. Here's another bunch of slices that were done by, Wendy Dart and Barnes. Can't think of Barnes' first name. But so they collected these things and had to cut them with a big saw. And then look at the banding patterns. And Wendy, for her, I think it was a master's or PhD work, she wanted to know how long is an individual polyp row? And one of you asked that. And the estimate is about 5 years. So looking at a bunch of different sawn specimens, they followed the growth path of individual polyps. And what happens is they eventually run into a depression and they're grown over by other polyps that are growing. So their mean longevity in the massive colonies anyway is about 5 years. This is a diagram that you can see it a little more easily. So here's a new polyp coming up here, but here's one that's run into, been overgrown by other polyps pushing it out of the way. So growth rate varies seasonally. Richard, do you have a question?
Oh, yeah, I was curious. Can they read, like, can they core a coral and read it like a sediment core?
Yeah. It's not really a sediment core, it's a skeletal core. Yeah. Right. And they actually cored old mama. And I objected. I said, come on, guys, don't do that. It could crack, right? They're in the middle of nowhere. The guys were, we were working at OFU, American Inuit. I can't start telling stories. But anyway, I said, don't do it. It was a group from Stanford. And they said, we have to, we're geologists. And I do it. And they did it. The guy who led the expedition was here for the, he was a guest speaker at the Tester Symposium last year. And he had video and photos to show me at this presentation to say, it was okay. It was okay. We took a risk, but we didn't break her into. They can take these cores, and you have to figure out, you know, if you're diving and if you, you have a drill and you press down on a coral, what happens? You push up. It's really hard to be heavy enough to push down on that drill. So that means you have to kind of straddle whatever you're doing. And so you take a risk, you know, in entering whatever you're working on. Anyway, they did it. So what we've looked at is that there are seasonal differences in growth rates. So longer days, summertime, you're going to grow more than you do in wintertime, and that's what results in the growth gap. But also, there's a difference in growth with latitude, right? Corals in Hawaii, what's our latitude here, by the way? About 21. Say that? What is that, 21? Right, so what's, and corals range from about 30 south, 30 north in their distribution. So we're getting up there. As you go in toward the northwest and the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, coral growth slows down. Days are shorter, water's cooler. Those entheleta aren't getting as much light, so they're not providing as much photosynthetic to their host. Coral growth slows down with increased latitude. Until, and these were actually cores taken, so good question, Richard. In massive corals, I think these are in Freddy's Lobata, all the way up the chain. So here's growth on the Big Island, Oahu, Necker, Laysan, Midway, and Kure, and you can see that the bands were smaller, growth was lower as you head up the chain. To the point where, and this was an idea that was first came, was first put out there by Dr. Ricky Grigg, that actually, let's see, where are we here? Oh, here's 19 degrees north. As you go further north, 24, 28, and further up, actually the coral reef can't keep up with the subduction, the subsidence of the heavy island that is growing around. And there's a point that he termed Darwin Point at 28 degrees north, where that's the balance. Growth is just barely balanced by subsidence any further north, and the reefs drown. So in Hawaii, we don't have, in the Hawaiian archipelago, we don't have reef accretion north of 28. Reef coral growth ceases, there's continued subsidence, and the atolls drown form. Another geological term is geo. So Darwin Point is a neat concept, something that you should definitely know. Dr. Sianam, in terms of what is Darwin Point or what's the significance of 28 degrees north. Okay, any questions about growth? Asexual reproduction? Great. I wanted to do this last week, but we ran out of time, so I want to put this out there for you to have, and that's the concept of the value of reefs. So why are you taking this class? Your parents ask, what's so cool about coral reefs? Well, there's some things that you can tell me. Coral reefs are the only biological structure that can be seen from space. I love this image from NASA. This is the Great Barrier Reef. How much reef is there on Earth? So of the 70% of the Earth that's deep ocean, 29% is land or freshwater, lakes, the percent of the Earth's surface that's coral reef is pretty darn small, 0.09%. Not much. They cover about 284 square kilometers, about the size of Nevada, half the size of France if you squish them all into one area. So in the big picture, not much. They're very important though. It turns out 500 million people, half a billion people, live within 60 miles of a coral reef. Doesn't that just blow your mind? So there's that little coral reef in the world that half a billion people live in that close of proximity. Reefs are photosynthetic, as you heard from Taylor. They sequester carbon, and they have tremendous productivity. So they have been a source of interest to biologists for a long time and continue to be. So here's some numbers for you. Global marine fisheries extract about 100 metric tons of fish from the ocean per year. About 9 million metric tons are coral reef fisheries. So that's 9%. And 0.09% of the total area of the Earth. That's 100 times the quote average productivities of any other ecosystem on Earth. So coral reefs are pretty important. So they have tremendous stocks, even in this small area, tremendous stocks. But as we'll hear time and time again, and we've read in the newspaper, we know coral reefs are tremendously vulnerable. Here's some of that productivity. So divers, friends, colleagues who have been up to the northwestern Hawaiian Islands come back with these amazing stories of what it's like up there. Not like when you jump into Hanama Bay or Lanikai, where in Lanikai you're lucky to see a fish because it's a little thing. But you jump in the water in the northwestern Hawaiian Islands and what do you see? Lots of fish. And most of them are big predators. So these are some jacks. And these jacks are driving the food chain up there. There are also a lot of sharks, but the divers that come back say they're a lot more worried about getting bumped or bit by a lua or a jack up there than by a shark, although there's a lot of sharks. You're going to have a presentation by Dr. Friedlander, who's really lucky to have because he's never here. He's always on an expedition diving somewhere, but he's going to talk about predators and top predators and their importance on you, so I'm not going to spend too much time on this today. But I want you to have this in your mind. In the main Hawaiian Islands versus the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, here's the big difference. In the mains, there are 3%. If you're lucky, if you can find any jacks and sharks on average, where there are about 55% of what you see are herbivores, things that scrape and eat algae. The reverse of the northwestern Hawaiian Islands, half of what you see are secondary consumers, top predators up there, and only about 28% herbivores. Okay, I'm going to go through this chart step by step and talk about some of the extractive uses that you might not be aware of on coral reefs. And some of these numbers are getting a little dated. It takes a lot of time and I kind of have to wait for new papers to come out. But this is the most recent numbers that of which I'm aware. So I mentioned that 500 million people live within 60 miles of coral reefs. And those are in more than 100 countries in tropical areas. And most of these countries are less developed. So their income may be derived from other sources than we're used to. They're not driving downtown and working in an office building, I'll tell you that. So tens of millions of people depend on reefs for at least part of their diet and their income. And it comes from fisheries and sometimes aquaculture. So here's some of the mean harvest numbers. 26 metric tons per kilometer, square kilometer per year in American Samoa, a little less than that in the Philippines, about 2 metric tons per kilometer, square kilometer per year in Kenya. That's everything that they take out of the sea. In many places in the Pacific, there's a very strange fishery, collecting live fish for food. For example, the Napoleon grass and the coral grouper, these guys go for big bucks. This is a luxury food, and in the market, oh, this fish, by the way, lives to be over 30 years. It's 2 meters in length. It's the most magnificent thing you've ever seen. They feed, they're very docile. They feed on mollusks and crown of thorns and crustaceans. These are the same name for the same fish. Either the Napoleon, the Mallory, or the humpback bass, same fish. But it ends up in the live fish market trade, in Hong Kong particularly, where just the set of lips of this fish goes for $400. You know, obviously you're not eating that because you're starving. It's a luxury food. Bêche de mer. What is that? Have you tasted bêche de mer? It's a